everyone, and welcome to the Norfolk coast, the North Norfolk coast to be precise. I'm situated between Munsley and Trivingham, a little way up ahead, about halfway between the two. And I'm going to take a walk all the way to Cromer. That's quite a long way, you might think. Probably going to take me about two and a half hours, and I've got about 2 and a bit hours until sunset. So that's what I'm trying to do. I want to get to the other end to capture the beautiful light of sunset when I get to Cromer. But first of all, I want to tell you that we're going to be looking at anything that we can find that's historical along here. Some things that are maybe good, some things that are maybe bad. But I'm hoping to uncover a lot of beauty as well along the way. First of all though, I'm going to take you up top. So although we're doing a coastal beach walk, I've got to take you up top first and show you something very, very significant. So up top where Munsley gun placements or battery are still located today, and they were built between 1940 and 1941 for the Eastern Command during the Second World War. And what a view they had. Look out across there. And immediately where I'm stood, you can see where original gun batteries were stationed. And that's the view that they would have had looking left and looking right to see of any incoming enemy craft or boats. And according to the Munsley Fort records, the battery was armed with 2 BLMK ex-naval 6-inch guns and manned by the 197 Battery Royal Artillery. The site was later reduced for care and maintenance in 1944, and just 2 years later in 1946 the guns were removed. Let's take a little look around and see if there's any reminder of what was once here. So immediately behind me, look, we've got this, and this is a former entrance with a steel or iron frame around that. And we can maybe get to have a little look inside. Just, if I can position the camera, you can see inside there, look, that is absolutely marvellous, isn't it? Who knows how far that goes under? But we can get a rough idea if we go around the side and follow it across the top. Another little ventilation hole just there, look. And we can see the full length of where we just came from. We started just there and we've made our way above all these concrete reinforced rooms. Potentially another entrance there. And there's another one just here where there would have been a gun battery on the other side. Let's run up and have a look. There it is, look. In the centre of shot, just like the very first one. Here's the remains of another boarded up entrance. Look, it looks as if it may have been infilled, because no one's getting in or out of that unless you're crawling. Or it could have just been there for some kind of ventilation. And down onto the second battery. Again, you can see where that was once welded in place and the line of sight looking out over the ocean. And again, another one of those doorways completely boarded up. Maybe a little peek inside. Not really much to see in that one. Fascinating place. Hope you enjoyed looking at that with me. I'm going to jump back down to the beach and I'll see you back down there. Right, I'm back down the bottom of the cliffs again. I'll show you up there, look. Look at that. You see where there's lots of erosion and where it's come down and crumbled. Who knows what we might find that's fell from up there and down here. Got the sea just there, look. So I'm going to push on now towards Trivingham Beach and see what's got to offer there. Now look at this here. These seats have been made up of old bits of... They look like railway line, don't they? I don't think they are. Or could they be old bits of discarded railway? Or is that the way they're manufactured? Call me thick if I'm completely wrong. But I've followed a lot of old railways in the last 3 years. And that kind of does look like really old railway. There's a property up there that looks precariously close to the edge. You can see where it's all eroded and collapsed over the past few years. But that looks like it's teetering. There's someone still living in there because I can see laundry hanging up in the windows. The roof, another one there. But that, there's probably more of a bit of land up there than it looks like between the edge and the property. But it doesn't look like that's got long left at all. Some remains here, it's fallen down, look, of some stone walling, stone and red brick wall, complete with red brick top. Look at that, lots of it. Look, there's even more that's come down from up there, and it's come crashing down one night, probably after some pretty bad weather. All this brick and concrete and probably remains of people's properties just laid all along here. Look at it all. All manner of variety of bits and pieces that were probably once people's homes and roads and drains, and they've all come crashing down. Look at the state of that. There's a property or two up there. A little bit more red brick that's come down there, probably off the top of a wall. But as we keep going and going, it's just strewn everywhere. Bit of iron grating just there, though. An old piece of industrial narrow gauge railway line in the middle of a Norfolk beach. Look at that, slight curve to both rails. Now there's two likely reasons that these are sat here in the first place. They were put in there when the new breakers was put up for the waves after a lot of flooding and bad weather in 1953, but they look a little bit older than that. Now the second reason that they was actually put in place to move and transport discarded bombs and war material from World War II, where they were then taken to a safer location along the beach away from populated areas to discard all manner of these wartime materials. Now, there's a little bit more over there that I'm going to show you. You can see where the waves and the tide and the sea have just whipped it up and left it where it is. I'm going to take you over and show you. Look at this. Exactly the same. I can take you all the way along it. Look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sleepers in this section of rail. And it's just amazing. Look at it. What a piece of history that is indeed. And that there is potentially one of the old, what you call fish plates on a normal railway line that held two rails or section of track together. Now, once I looked into everything I'd seen that day and filmed and took pictures of, I did a little more research online, and another version of events came to light.
In 1974, a construction railway was apparently positioned behind the concrete and wooden defences as they were being built. But multiple cliff collapses left equipment damaged and forced the abandonment of the sections of track. So we've now got a third version of events of when this railway was built. But looking at this picture in particular I'm showing you now, this looks a lot older than 1974. It may just be that it's grainy and black and white, but for 1974, I'd have thought it was more likely that these photographs would have been taken in colour. Who knows? Somebody out there hopefully does. And if we take a look at Google Maps to see exactly where we are, we're just down on Trimmingham Beach. And looking at this map dating back to 1906, you can see where's the mark of the ordinary tide and the mark of the high ordinary tide. And finally, we can jump over to a very reliable source of maps which show us where former railway lines, industrial lines and narrow gauge railways are. You can see the blue line on the left hand side. That is the line that ran from Cromer off towards North Walsham. But you can see along the beach, there's no such marking of any kind of railway line whatsoever.
Right, just left those two pieces of railway track behind and this is the remains of an old lorry. Look at this. Look at that. So that's clearly come crashing down there at some point, and that is unbelievable, isn't it? The fact it's laying the right way up as well. The rusted mess and hulk of this lorry. Look at all the stones that's been washed between the wheel rim and the tyre and just lodged there over time. Right, the railway track history gets even better. You know, you thought it was good when we saw those two pieces of track back there. Now it looks like an entire Hornby railway set has been dumped on the floor here on this beach. Come and take a look at this. That is absolutely loads of the stuff, and there's a section here, it's even upside down, so we get a better understanding of what the sleepers are actually like. Look, they're hollowed out underneath the iron, and you see the rivets, large rivets just there, it's been welded in there to hold it all together. And the angle here, it clearly was a curve of some sort by the positioning of those iron sleepers. There's more of it, look, look at it, look at this long section here. I don't know how far this is actually going to go on, but I can see it quite a way further down there. Dead ahead of me, there's quite a long section, and it's very snake-like, but it's all still joined together. I'd say it must be the length of about a standard swimming pool. Take a look at this. It starts just there, look. You can see it goes all the way up there. I don't think there's much more beyond this. So I've checked historically, there was never anything up the top that had anything like this, like a narrow gauge industrial railway. So it's not something, you can see the way it's just in this locked section, it's not come down there off cliff top erosion. So again, you can see where this track, the sections are actually joined together. Look, We've got the fish plates with two bolts on either side. You can just make out a gap in the rail just there. Exactly the same on the other side. We'll go along back the way we just come from and we'll see if we can find the next joint. There we go, look, it's just there, look. One, two, three, four bolts. Same on the other side. And the gap in the rail is right about there. On the other side is two discarded pieces of rail, look. It's probably never used. See, it looks actually a completely different depth. That's a different width, isn't it? It may have had nothing to do with this, because that is quite a shallow piece of track just there. And it appears as this just one rail that tapers off and then disappears for good. You can see where there was another piece attached, look, at the other end, but it has gone. Well, what an absolutely amazing sight that was, wasn't it? That's two potential war-related things that we've come across in this walk so far. Or maybe it really was to build flood defences back in the 1950s. No more rail, it's all gone. We've left that behind down there. Starting to lose a little bit of light now, and I've got a good hour and a half to walk before I get to Cromer, so I think it's going to be pretty dark as I get back. So we've now passed Sidestrand and Overstrand is just a little way over there. I'm about 20 minutes away from sunset, so that's not going to be happening when I get to Cromer. It's going to be happening before. It's probably going to be happening around about the time I get to Overstrand, to be fair. So we will start to lose the light. I'm hoping I can still finish the entire journey, even though light will be very, very low. When I get to Cromer, it could still be really, really beautiful. Might even be able to get the drone up near the lighthouse. Just look at this beautiful palette of colours over there. I've lost a lot of the clear sky over there. It isn't thick cloud, it's very, very thin, but it's made it look quite hazy. And then we turn into this kaleidoscope of pinks and yellows and blues and oranges as we head off towards, I can see the wind farm out at sea in the distance. And as I said in the previous clip, Overstrand is just ahead. You can still see clearly all manner of rock and sandstone. It almost looks like old discarded clay in places as it has come careering down when they've had bad weather and high tides. Thank you. There's some absolutely stunning colours in the sky right now, and it's bouncing off the sea as it roars in. The tide went out around about 20 minutes ago. That's as far as it's going to go before it starts to come in again. Look at this. Look at those colours. It's like a light display coming over the top of the cliffs. And that beautiful pink. It's unbelievable, isn't it? It just goes to show you, we don't need brilliant daytime sunshine, whatever, to get some beautiful, beautiful footage on these lovely walks. What more can I say? I'm so happy down here. Been a lighthouse on the edge of Cromer since 1669. Prior to that, there was actually a light shone from Cromer Parish Church Tower from the top to ward away any passing ships and boats that could end up getting into trouble. The present lighthouse, that was constructed in 1833 to replace the original one, which was expected to crumble and just disappear. But it was originally built half a mile from the cliff edge. I'll show you now. Lighthouse is in centre of shot. Cliff edge is just there. That is certainly not half a mile. I've been so lucky to capture this glorious light again by coming up to the top of the cliff edge, because if we'd have stayed down on the beach like we did for the most of the other part of the walk from Trimmingham, we wouldn't have seen this. We'd have been down in the dark. It's a lot darker down there. But look at this. You could just make out the lighthouse in the middle with that light rotating around. In 1935, the lighthouse, it was part electrified from being solely gas to electricity and gas. And by 1958, it was fully electrified. So I do hope you've enjoyed this walk from Trimmington, going all the way along the sea, the coastline and the cliffs off towards Cromer Lighthouse. We've seen some really good stuff en route, hasn't we? I'm going to head off down to Cromer now. I'm not going to take you to the pier in this one, because I'm going to show you that in a completely different video, probably shortly after this one. I am still in Norfolk. Take care, and I'll see you in the very next one.